My name is Meriwether Lewis, and I have an extraordinary tale to tell you. I spent some time around these parts when I was young. I would go hunting and tromping through these woods, pretending to be off on a big adventure. Little did I know what lay in store for me. If someone had told me back then about all the adventures that awaited me in my life, I would have called them crazy. Science and exploration, politics and publishing? Well, I get ahead of myself. Let's go back to the beginning. I was born in August of 1774 in the state of Virginia and named after my mama, whose maiden name was Meriwether. We lived near Thomas Jefferson and our family spent some time together. After Daddy died of pneumonia, Mama married Captain John Marks. All three of us moved down to Georgia in May of 1780. We settled just along the Broad River in the Goose Pond community. Back then it was in Wilkes County, but you'll know that area now as Oglethorpe County. I loved my new home and spent as much time outdoors as I could. I would take my dog Ranger and we would go off on adventures roaming the land. I was an avid hunter and honed my marksmanship skills. They would serve me well later in the military. Mama also taught me about all the plants and herbs growing on our property, some more useful knowledge for my later travels. After a happy childhood in Goose Pond, I returned to Virginia in 1787 at age 13 to claim my property inheritance and to begin schooling for the first time. I eventually finished, and in 1793, joined the Virginia Militia. 2 years later, I joined the U.S. Army, commissioned as an ensign, what you would call a lieutenant. In 1800, I was promoted to captain, and my commanding officer was Captain William Clark. A year later, I left the military, intending to spend my days as a farmer, tending the family property. But in 1801, President Thomas Jefferson called me to service as his personal secretary. I lived in the presidential mansion and socialized with many prominent figures in politics and the arts of the day, a far cry from being a gentleman farmer. President Jefferson wanted to explore the wilds of the Louisiana Territory to get a better sense of the land, to understand the resources it offered, but most importantly, to declare U.S. sovereignty over American Indians along the Missouri River. He remembered my love of the natural sciences and chose me to lead the expedition called Corps of Discovery. Now, I could not have been happier. Just imagine a rambunctious young lad, one day exploring the wilds along the Broad River, and the next, being asked by our president to lead an exploration across new lands. I asked my old military friend, Captain Clark, to join me for the journey. The adventure began in St. Louis, Missouri in May of 1804. As we traveled across the expanse of the territory, I kept a detailed journal and collected samples of plants and animals that we encountered. We survived treacherous waters, harsh weather, fatigue, hunger, illness, and many injuries. During the first winter of our travels, we were joined by Sacagawea, a 15-year-old Shoshone woman, the wife of a fur trader. In November of 1805, after crossing the Rocky Mountains, we finally arrived at the Pacific Ocean, in an area that you might call Oregon. I finally returned home in 1806 with a wealth of information and many plant and animal specimens. After our journey, President Jefferson and all Americans knew that the United States was destined to expand all the way to the Pacific coast. For a job well done, President rewarded me with 1,600 acres of land and appointed me governor of the Louisiana Territory. I settled in St. Louis, Missouri, and began making plans to publish my travel journals. In 1808, I also served as the first master of the new Freemason Lodge for St. Louis. In September of 1809, I set off on a new journey, this time to Washington, D.C., intending to deliver my travel journals to the publisher. At first, I planned to travel by ship, all the way from St. Louis to Washington. But, somewhere out on the Mississippi River, fate took its course when I changed my mind and decided to travel overland on the Natchez Trace Trail. I died at an inn there on October 10th, 1809. The mystery surrounding what happened that night at the inn is still debated today by historians, writers, and filmmakers. My book, The History of the Lewis and Clark Expedition, was finally printed in 1893, so that everyone could join me in my journey. So remember, dream big dreams, and one day you may find yourself exploring at the edge of a new world and beyond. Thank you all for coming to spend time with me today.